different assays, there's different calibration standards, and it does seem like there's differences in the assays. That's kind of come up in our own work, and I'll give more examples of that.
Can you click those?
Oh, yep. I got to go to that screen. There it is. Okay. All right. So there was a study that came out in 2023, I believe, where they basically they plotted individuals. This is from NHANES, which is a National Health Survey, general population in the United States, and they tried to filter out people who reported health conditions. So it's supposed to be a pretty healthy population. They plotted each individual's serum ferritin on the x-axis and their hemoglobin on the y, and then they wanted to try and find a physiologically based definition for iron deficiency. So they fit this restricted cubic spline with 5 knots, and they found that, okay, there's this saddle point at the population level right around 25 nanograms per milliliter of ferritin. Micrograms per liter is the same thing as, anyway. And so basically they said, maybe this is what we should use to define the iron deficiency threshold. So my colleagues in the Netherlands and Finland, they're like, okay, let's look at this with our blood donor data. We've got data with ferritin and with hemoglobin, and let's see what happens. And they did something a bit different because they did bootstrap resampling to try different levels of splines, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And they found that in each bootstrap resample, A, whether 5 splines fit better than 4 or 6 or 7 changed all of the time, and that the actual saddle point moved all over the place. So we were thinking, okay, maybe this isn't the best way to define a hemoglobin threshold because it doesn't seem to stand up to these kinds of more uncertainty analyses, but maybe there's something there with the ferritin and the hemoglobin. So we came up with a new idea, which is in blood donors where we've got the fingertip hemoglobin and we've got ferritin, can we compare the blood donor's hemoglobin at this visit to when they first started donating, so before blood donation had impacted their iron stores, and can the difference between the baseline and the current hemoglobin tell us something about their iron sufficiency? So the idea is that we take a reference hemoglobin, which is either their first ever hemoglobin, or if they had like a 2-year gap in their donation career, we assume when they came back after 2 years that that hemoglobin is probably not affected by iron donation, so we can use that one as a reference. And then we take the hemoglobin at any visit where we measured ferritin, and we've got some blood loss between the reference and the follow-up. And then we calculate the difference, the change in hemoglobin, so the follow-up minus the reference. So it's going to be greater than 1 if their hemoglobin is now bigger than when they started, less than 1 if their hemoglobin is now lower, and their log ferritin. And then we just looked at these population level association between these two measures. So when I plot, this is just for male donors in the Netherlands, you get this big blob with people's change in hemoglobin on the y-axis and their ferritin on the x. And then we did this rolling mean. And what we see is that the rolling mean tends to be kind of, for lower ferritins, we've got the change in hemoglobin tends to be negative, but increasing up to a point. And then it seems to level out pretty close to 0. And we did this change point analysis where we fit 2 line segments meeting at a change point. And we did bootstrap resampling to try and quantify our uncertainty. And we saw that, you know, that it does seem to be that there is a change point in this population level association around 30 nanograms per milliliter. So maybe this would be an alternative to what the CDC researchers did, is another way to try and define iron deficiency based on physiological measures. So we also looked at this and for women stratified by age to premenopausal and postmenopausal, we see slightly lower change points, but we see the same general relationship. And that was in the Dutch data. My lab has American and South African data. We collaborate with colleagues at Cambridge who have UK data and Finnish data. They have fewer ferritin measures. They've got a lot more uncertainty. But we see similar trends, but different change points. But in general, we see that the change point for men is a little higher than it is for women. We're not quite sure what's attributable to all of these differences across the populations. We think that it could be the composition of the populations and their racial makeup, perhaps. We also think that the assays being used and specifically what they're calibrated to might be differing. So we found a strong population level association. We think that a negative change in hemoglobin might be suggestive of iron deficiency. The limitation is this is a noisy population level association. So you see there's all these people in this upper left quadrant. Their ferritin is below what our functional threshold would be, but they have positive change in hemoglobin. And it may not be portable to other settings if the ferritin measures differ. So I presented this at a blood banking meeting in October, and people thought like, okay, this is interesting for defining iron deficiency, but the audience, they all largely work at blood collectors, and they more wanted to know, could we use this as part of the donor eligibility criteria? So instead of using absolute hemoglobin, or maybe in combination with absolute hemoglobin, can we use people's change from baseline as a better way to find a better balance between who should be able to donate and to identify who should be able to donate to balance the risk of iron deficiency, taking blood from people with iron deficiency against we don't want to turn donors away. So Matthew Chin, while he's in the room, is working on an analysis to look at this. The biggest challenge though is that we only measure ferritin in the data sets we have access to when a donation is completed. So if your hemoglobin is too low to donate, we don't know what your ferritin is. So with that limitation, we are trying to look at this a little bit. And one preliminary result. So this is what's called a decision curve analysis, which is a way to kind of assess any kind of model or metric that's being used to try and identify who's going to have an outcome. So here our outcome is giving a donation when your ferritin is below 12 nanograms per milliliter, which is the typical breath cutoff used for absent iron stores. The population is the non-deferred repeat donors who had a ferritin measured. And what you can see here is this red line, the change in hemoglobin, for certain kind of levels of where you would want to kind of make that trade-off between wanting to minimize deferrals and get as much blood as you can and minimize collections from donors with absent iron stores. This red line that indicates using change in hemoglobin as a threshold is above this blue line, which indicates increasing the absolute hemoglobin threshold. So we can't really assess lowering the absolute hemoglobin threshold because we don't measure ferritin in people who are deferred in the status quo, but we can measure increasing it. And we see that because the red line is below the blue line, that suggests that there's higher net benefit with the absolute, with the change in hemoglobin, this new measure, for at least some levels of where you would trade off kind of this protecting donors versus protecting the supply, I guess, and minimizing deferrals. So very preliminary, but I think this is the blood centers are certainly interested if there's any way to kind of do a better job of deferring donors. I think they'd be quite happy. Okay, so that's what I have on hemoglobin change from baseline as an alternative to absolute hemoglobin for defining iron deficiency or for qualifying donors. Happy to take any questions at this point. All right, feel free to interject at any point. So next I'm going to talk about predicting iron recovery after donation. So this work is focused on after someone completes a donation, how long until they should come back to donate again. So that's kind of the policy lever that we're trying to inform here. And this started during my PhD. So this paper from 2019 was kind of the first machine learning model work that I did in this area. And it was a multi-class prediction model. So we take someone who completes a donation, they come back at minimum 56 days later, because that's the minimum donation interval. And we observe when they come back, were they deferred for low hemoglobin? Or if they gave a donation successfully and ferritin was measured, we can classify them as having had low iron. We use these thresholds in our particular paper, or an absent iron, which is below 12 nanograms per milliliter. So we took data from this RISE study, which is in US blood donors from three different blood collectors back in 2011 to 2013, I believe, which has extra covariates that we don't typically get for blood donors because they did questionnaires about diet, whether they use iron supplements or multivitamins, reproductive health indicators, so about like menstruation, which of course impacts your iron status, And then we had ferritin and soluble transferrin receptor measured for certain visits, and then body iron, which is a calculation based on ferritin. And then we observed when they come back, did they have any of these outcomes? But because ferritin was not measured at every return donation, we also have some people where they return and we have what we call an unknown iron donation. And we had to factor that into our design, which I'll talk about a little bit. So the basic idea is that we took this RISE data set, which was 2,424 donors over 2 years, and we pre-processed it into the model development set. So everything is labeled. So there's people who completed a donation, but we didn't measure their ferritin. They would not be in this model development data set. And then we have our first return data set, which is more representative. And then we developed the model with the model development data set using nested cross-validation. And we assess discriminative performance with the area under the ROC curve and variable importance. And then for the first return data set, we use that to calibrate our model to reflect the fact that our training data set was biased. And then we generated what we called individual risk trajectories for each donor. So how long, depending on how long you wait until you come back, we basically how much we predict your risk of each of these outcomes will be. And then we also came up with this pretty simple tailored interdonation interval algorithm and then tried to simulate how that would trade off supplies efficiency against avoiding these adverse outcomes compared to alternative policies. So we used different machine learning models. We assessed under the ROC curve with the multi-class method. And because ferritin and soluble transferrin receptor are not typically measured by blood collectors, we wanted to see how well you could predict without those additional biomarkers versus with them. The top model ended up being in both settings with ferritin and transferrin receptor and without, ended up being an ensemble of multiple base models. So this is the area under the ROC curve, the multi-class area under the ROC curve of the ensemble model in blue, and then the models that comprise it in red. And then here's the actual performance of the top model. So this is the one versus other area under the ROC curve. So it's showing that it's easiest to discriminate no adverse outcomes versus the other three. And it's the hardest to disambiguate the low iron donations. It seems to be that's because if your iron's low, you may be hemoglobin deferred or you may not. And you're like close to the border. You could be close to the border with absent iron stores or not, or close to the border with having no adverse outcomes or not. So I think it kind of makes sense that that's the hardest one to disambiguate from the others. And we see that when you add in ferritin and soluble transferrin receptor, the overall area under the ROC curve increases by 5% absolute. And the gains are seen most in disambiguating an absent iron donation or a low iron donation from the other outcomes, which I think makes sense because low iron and absent iron are defined based on the ferritin when you come back. So it seems to make sense that the ferritin at this visit will help me predict your ferritin when you come back. When you don't have ferritin and soluble transferrin receptor, the time until you come back is very important. Your hemoglobin is very important. How many units of red cells you've donated in the last 2 years, and your finger stick hemoglobin, these are all important. But when you add in ferritin and soluble transferrin receptor, ferritin is the best thing for predicting your return outcomes, followed by time to return. Soluble transferrin receptor didn't make the top few lists. So that extra biomarker doesn't seem to add very much for predicting return outcomes based on ferritin and hemoglobin. So then I mentioned these individual risk trajectories. So each of these panels represents a single patient. The x-axis is how many days until they came back. And we start with 56 days because you're not allowed to come back any earlier. So we have no data for that. And then the height of these colored regions indicates the likelihood of each of those outcomes if they come back that many days later. So you see that for this first donor, they are very likely to have an adverse outcome if they come back 56 days later, but the likelihood goes down with time. For the second donor, this person seems to be unlikely to have an adverse outcome even if they come back 56 days later. And if we plot, this is, I think, 20 different people. You can see that there's tremendous variation between, people with pretty low adverse outcome risk, like this person, or this person especially, people with relatively high adverse outcome risk that goes down with time, like this person. And then we see people like this person here, who the model predicts that they're almost certainly gonna have absent iron stores, even if they wait almost a year to come back. So maybe these are people that the model is suggesting don't need to be donating blood in the first place. So we can classify people's risk trajectories based on either fast recoverers, so they're good to go 56 days later, the model estimates, slower recoverers who have relatively high risk that drops if they wait longer to come back, and then what we call chronically high risk. So maybe the model perhaps is picking up that they have some underlying cause of iron deficiency that's not going to be fixed by waiting longer. So we then develop this decision rule where we can assign a risk threshold to, you know, what's the maximum risk we'll tolerate for a hemoglobin deferral or absent iron donation or low iron donation. And then we just find the time for which that the model is estimating that donor will basically be below the threshold for each of our adverse outcomes. And we compared personalizing the interdonation interval with this kind of, with this algorithm to what if we moved from what the US is currently doing to what Canada is doing, Australia is doing, or the UK is doing, where we've got longer intervals for one or both sexes. And we estimated how many collections we would get from this population if that's what we were doing, and the rate of hemoglobin deferrals, low iron donations, absent iron donations. The caveat is this is a very simple model, and these donors are not representative of the typical donor population. But with that said, we did find that for each of the tailored policies, you can identify a corresponding version of the tailored interdonation interval where you're getting a smaller drop in collections relative to the status quo. So if you look at this Australian one, we've got, if you apply the Australian one, we lose about 18% of all of our collections. You can find a tailored approach that loses 17%, so a little bit better, but with considerable improvements in the rate of hemoglobin deferrals. So we're dropping it by 57%, 47% with the tailored approach versus 25%, and the adverse iron outcomes. So we're dropping absent iron donations by 37% with the tailored approach versus only 12% with the Australian interval. Now we do see a slight increase, like slightly less performance with low iron donations, but it turns out this is because as your risk of hemoglobin deferral or absent iron donations goes down, like you're more likely to kind of go into that low iron ferritin zone versus getting before you get all the way up to having a normal ferritin, like in the no adverse event area. So we thought this was encouraging. As a follow-up study, we're training a model on the RISE data set again. This study data set, well, I guess I got the dates wrong. It's from 2007 to 2009. So it's fairly old data. And then we're taking more recent data from our collaborators in the United States, South Africa, and the Netherlands to externally validate a model. Now it's not the same model because we had all of these extra covariates in the RISE study that we don't routinely collect. So it's a bit of a smaller set of covariates for this model, but that's a subset of what we had in that first one. And we're predicting hemoglobin as a continuous outcome and log 10 ferritin as a continuous outcome rather than doing the multi-class model this time. But again, we don't measure ferritin at all visits. So we constructed two data sets in each of the four settings, one where we do include ferritin as a covariate and one where we only measure hemoglobin. So you can see that the size of the operational data sets we have is considerably bigger than the older training data set. We use three repeats of fivefold cross-validation to select the top model, considering a lot of different model types, the same ones as before, plus cat boost, which I didn't know back in 2019 when I was doing that other paper. And we're using nested cross-validation to get an unbiased estimate of performance in the training data. Now I'm gonna show you results where the training data is just based on running the whole model in the training data set. So it may be overfit, but before we submit the paper, we're gonna finish using this procedure to get a less biased estimate of how the model selection process works in the training data set. And our main metric is root mean squared percent error. We wanted to use percent error just because That way, it's more easy to compare the hemoglobin models to the ferritin models rather than just mean squared error. So here's the preliminary results. We haven't rerun the models in the Netherlands yet after making some corrections. But we do see that if you look at just the red, the training data set, we see that predicting hemoglobin, we do pretty well with a percent error below 6% when we have ferritin in the data set. And it's only 6.1%, so it's not too much worse when we don't have ferritin. So adding in ferritin doesn't help that much with predicting hemoglobin as the outcome. But when you're predicting ferritin as your outcome, it does seem like it's harder to predict. So the root mean squared error in the model with both hemoglobin and ferritin is about 13. And when you don't have ferritin at baseline, you do a lot worse. Your prediction score is almost, your error is almost doubled. And when it comes to external validation, it seems to be pretty reasonable that the performance is never more than 45% worse. And when you're externally validating to the United States, which is the same country where the study was done back in 2007 to 2009, we actually see that the model is better in two instances in the more recent US data than the original study data once it was trained. So that's quite encouraging. And then we do see that when you have ferritin involved, the external validation is a bit worse, particularly in South Africa. And if results are similar to the first time we did it in the Netherlands, it'll probably be a bit worse in the Netherlands too. And we think this might be the systematic bias in ferritin measurement, the same type of issue we saw in the change in hemoglobin analysis, where the ferritin measures may not be calibrated the same, is likely, if possibly, driving the fact that the models predicting hemoglobin externally validate better than the models predicting ferritin. Yes.
Is there any chance that some of the patients in the validation set from the US were also already donors in the original data set?
I mean, it would be a gap of 12 years. So it's possible that some of the donors in RISE, but even if every single donor from RISE was also in the US, they would still be less than 20% of the data set. So I don't think that's a I think it's unlikely. And also, when you age 10 years, your iron process is a bit different. So I think, yeah, so it's possible that they might be there, but I doubt it would be more than a handful. And B, it's yeah, because only one of the three blood centers that was in the RISE study was Vitalant. So 2/3 of these donors were donating at different blood operators anyway. So yeah, so it's possible, but I think it's not likely to be a kind of why the model does so well in the US. That's a good question. So anyway, so we still have a bit of work to do here. It's not quite finished, but I think it's promising. So to kind of wrap up this section on predicting iron recovery after donation, it does seem like there's a lot of person-to-person variability, but it does seem like we can predict it reasonably well. Which I think suggests that the interdonation interval after a completed donation is a good candidate for personalization. But the one limitation is that we don't measure ferritin in people with low hemoglobin. So our kind of performance in predicting ferritin has to be interpreted in that context, right? If someone's hemoglobin was below the cutoff, they have a hemoglobin of 10. They didn't have their ferritin measured and therefore weren't included in the training or validation set for predicting ferritin. Any questions or comments on this? We'll probably go to the last study, which will be shorter. All right, so next I'm going to talk about analyzing donor return behavior. So Huzba was a master's student who just finished in January and went on to a job with a clinical trial software company. But his paper, we actually just got the reviews back. So it looks like it's likely to be published in Transfusion within the next few months. So why do we care about donor return behavior? Well, because another piece of this whole puzzle that determines this trade-off between supply sufficiency and donor health is when donors present to donate. So we tell donors, what's the minimum interval? When are you allowed to come back? But donors don't come back as soon as they're eligible a lot of the time. So what we wanted to do in this study was to use kind of epidemiological methods to look at donor return behavior in the United States and South Africa. Now, there's been a few studies looking at time to return for blood donors, but they've been mostly in the United States or in Europe. So having South Africa was nice. And also our data spans the COVID-19 pandemic. So it was also an opportunity to try and see under these kind of exceptional circumstances, what happened in these two countries. So what we took operational data from 2017 to 2022 from South Africa and from our US blood operator Vitalant. And what we're predicting time until donors came back from when they're first eligible. So if you complete a donation in both of these countries, you're eligible again 56 days later. But if you get a deferral, then depending on what you're deferred for, that there'll be an associated duration until you can come back. So we're predicting return from when you're eligible again. And there are some differences in the deferral policies between these two countries, so which is part of why predicting from the eligibility date makes things somewhat comparable. And we looked at time to return using Kaplan-Meier curves. We looked at did people come back? Did mobile donors come back to mobile drives or go to fixed drives and vice versa using cumulative incident functions? And then we developed Cox proportional hazard models to identify what are kind of predictors or correlates of return. So what characteristics make donors more likely to come back earlier? And we did stratified analyses by mobile and fixed environments and the pre and the intra-pandemic period. So Kaplan-Meier results were largely consistent with other studies in the sense that first-time donors are less likely to come back than people who are already repeat donors. People at mobile drives are less likely to come back than people at fixed sites. And if you're deferred, it decreases the likelihood that you'll come back. Now, one interesting thing is the plot on the left is South Africa, and all of these curves are much higher for South Africa, indicating that South African donors are just more likely to come back. So maybe perhaps they're more loyal donors. And then this cumulative incident suggested that people who donate at a fixed site are more likely to come back to another fixed site. People who donate at a mobile drive are likely to come back at a mobile drive. So there's not a lot of switching between the fixed site and the mobile drives in both countries. And we see that mobile drive donors, as I said in the last slide, tend to come back slower, and that's more pronounced in the US than it is in South Africa. So I'm not going to go through all of the details of the predictors of fast return. But one thing that's interesting is that all the categories of deferral in the United States were associated with being slower to return. And that was also true of South Africa in the pre-COVID-19 period. But one thing that's interesting is if you look at like this, the interaction term between being hemoglobin deferred and being a first-time donor. So in the pre-COVID-19 period for fixed sites here and for mobile sites here, value was less than one, indicating that people with both of those characteristics are less likely to come back. But in the intra-pandemic period, it actually became associated with faster return. And we also see that non-hemoglobin deferral categories of deferrals flipped at both fixed sites and at mobile drives from being associated with slower return to being associated with faster return. Actually, it didn't quite flip for the fixed sites, but the coefficient became much closer to one, indicating that it was still associated with slower return, but by a much less magnitude. And I think this, in talking to our collaborators, they weren't surprised because during the pandemic, it was so hard to recruit new donors. So they were on their repeat donors and deferred donors like white on rice to get them back in the door as soon as they could. They really ramped up their efforts to get deferred donors back in the door as soon as possible. And the data seems to suggest that those efforts were successful. So to discuss this paper, the main takeaways for this audience, I think, is that donor return depends on donor behavior and blood donor policies and operations. It's different in different countries and even in the same country during different periods, although the COVID pandemic is pretty exceptional, but we saw a lot of changes. And that we like all these other studies had said, being deferred dampens your likelihood of ever coming back or how soon you come back. But the experience of South Africa and the pandemic suggests that blood center efforts can kind of mitigate this effect. So next I want to talk about kind of bringing these things together and kind of our future plans. So we really want to think about this as a system and move from kind of looking at one policy lever at a time to building a simulation model where we can assess combinations of policies. So offering iron supplementation and changing the hemoglobin threshold, like what Hema-Quebec is currently studying. Can we do in silico assessment and optimization of different combinations of policies to try and identify what's the optimal set of policy levers for a given setting, given their own situation with donor behavior, difficulty of recruiting new donors, how many people in the general population are even eligible to be donors, et cetera, et cetera. And then of course, we would like to move to actually having our research impact real operations. But there's a lot of pieces that need to be looked at around informatics and the IT system. You know, will the blood collecting will the staff at the blood centers be able to handle this? What is the best design for them? Or will the donors accept this? And of course, we want to kind of run pilot studies. So to kind of give an idea of where our simulation work is going, we can use work like the penalized Cox model I presented to simulate the time until donors will come back if they're assigned, you know, X deferral period or this interdonation interval period. And then we can take donors' covariate along with like a simulated time until they came back to use our machine learning models to simulate the likelihood that they'll have a completed donation, a hemoglobin deferral, low iron stores, regular iron stores when they come back. So all of this can be kind of embedded into a discrete event simulation model that's used to optimize, to try and find the optimal trade-off between our policy objectives. We're also looking at simplified decision rules. So this I got from a paper by Cynthia Rudin and colleagues, where you can take a machine learning model and then create a simplified decision, you know, scoring tool that's easier to implement in a setting where either you don't have the technological infrastructure to run a whole machine learning model in real time on every patient, or maybe you even have the infrastructure, but it's just not really acceptable to either the staff or the donors because it's too black box. Like sometimes a more transparent policy can be preferred. So we're working on kind of developing these methods to try and find that optimal trade-off between precision, you know, being as precise about when your iron will have recovered enough to come back and the interpretability and implementability. I think another thing that will be of interest maybe to this audience with more of a, because it has a bit more of a biological slant, is looking at mechanistic models of iron recovery after blood donation. So machine learning models are entirely data driven, right? So they don't always extrapolate well to settings where the data, we don't have data. And I think an example of that would be, I think there's no guarantees our machine learning models are going to do well at predicting ferritin in people who under the status quo policies are being deferred for low hemoglobin. But in mechanistic models are where they're often differential equations or delayed differential equations or partial differential equation models, where you embed kind of your understanding based on animal studies, human studies, et cetera, of the processes of iron metabolism or iron homeostasis. And you can kind of have hybrid approaches where the modeling is kind of, the structure is based on this biological understanding, and then, but it's calibrated to actual data to try and get differences across sex and race and different factors. What we want to do is to kind of take some preliminary work that's been done in this area, looking at iron recovery and blood donors, calibrate it to our data sets, and compare it to the machine learning models. I think there aren't too many head-to-head comparisons in any kind of health application of machine learning and mechanistic models. So I think it's methodologically a pretty interesting question to look at. Okay, so the main takeaways are that we are capable of developing and assessing personalized approaches to this challenge of iron deficiency in blood donors with a combination of different methods, machine learning, optimization and simulation, and then hopefully soon mechanistic models. That's all I have. Thank you very much for your attention. I want to recognize my many collaborators. I'm happy to take any questions. Yes.
You showed that showed that itself after having a stronger intended goal was almost to return blood banks in comparison to the US. Have you tried to look as to if that's just because of policy? Like you had mentioned that South Africa during the pandemic was a lot more active in kind of recruiting their donors. Or do you think that's more like a policy issue? Was that almost like a cultural socioeconomic issue?
Yeah, so donors, you know how donors in South Africa tend to come back much faster than the American donors? Yeah, so we think it's most likely due to policy. So South Africa, compared to European or North American countries, they have a smaller eligible donor base because there's a higher prevalence of nutrition-associated iron deficiency. It has one of the highest prevalences of HIV in the world, which is, of course, you know, you can't donate blood if you're HIV positive. And there's also, because the incidence of HIV is also higher, they also, the blood collector also likes to rely on repeat blood donors because the rate of incident HIV in a first-time donor is typically higher than in repeat donors. And we have really, really good HIV nucleic acid test screening now, but there still is that window period where if someone comes in with a new infection where it's just low enough to not be detected by the screening test, and but high enough to actually transmit to the transfusion recipient. So for all of those reasons, I think that South Africa has tried to create a culture within their blood donors of being like loyal repeat blood donors and coming back often. I think they ramped up specifically during the pandemic their efforts to get deferred donors back in faster, but they always have been pretty proactive about trying to get the completed donors to come back fast. I think that's the main reason. But I think that the other side of the coin, though, is that because the prevalence of iron deficiency is higher in South Africa, you know, perhaps it would be good to take a more tailored approach to balancing. And because they have so many donations per year from so many of these donors, I think that question of the optimal balance between maintaining the repeat donor base so we have enough blood and not bleeding people dry is especially important there. Other questions
online? Are there questions online? Maybe
there is a chat.
Speaker, no, that's actually me.
Okay.
Yeah. Can you invite anybody who's online to have a question, Alton, because you're closer to speaking?
Yeah, so anyone who's online, feel free to unmute and ask a question. Raise your hand.
I had a question about the differential equation modeling ideas that you have at the end.
Yes.
Do you think those can be crystallized?
Yeah, so the models that have been done so far, so if you didn't hear, the question was whether these kind of mechanistic models can be personalized. So you certainly can. I think the idea would be that so these models are kind of measure over time. You give a donation, you know, your hemoglobin and iron have like an instantaneous change, and then it's kind of the gradual recovery of those two. So you can imagine kind of those two lines of hemoglobin and ferritin changing with time. So I think you certainly could kind of start a model at a given point in time where you've got like, you know, this much loss of iron. So the this was the measure of ferritin and hemoglobin before the donation. This is the drop because we know a donation has this much of each in it. And then like, so you could use the lab values certainly to measure change from time. And you can also do, you can stratify different transitions by all kinds of covariates. So certainly sex would be a good one to do. And age either continuously or kind of, at least for women, you probably want to stratify by age because of blood loss through menstruation. So I think that there are certainly ways to personalize these, and I haven't looked into it too much, but there are these hybrid approaches that kind of you can even do ensemble modeling of a mechanistic model and a machine learning model. So there's a lot of possibilities.
Yeah, but if you have somebody coming back really frequently, like in South Africa, then you should be able to predict exactly like that person how frequently they can normally come back, right?
Yeah, I think. I mean, we've been thinking more along the lines of, I mean, yeah, you could actually, for certain donors, if you have enough data, you could see about calibrating just to the donor. Like, yeah, so you can certainly start the model at a certain place and take the covariates like age, sex, et cetera. But yeah, maybe you could actually recalibrate a model to an individual if you've got enough, if you have enough data. Yeah, I think. Eventually.
Yeah. Is that something that has actually been discussed to sort of really say, okay, you seem to eat a lot of, you know, spinach or whatever, you should come back more frequently, and or is that doesn't really happen?
Yeah, I mean, I think the in the machine learning models, the covariates that are most important are the baseline biomarkers. The RISE data set, we did have nutrition and it made it into the mix. So anyway, so I think it's, yeah, so basically the composite heme iron score, which is based on like an inventory of what they've been eating, you know, it did contribute to the machine learning model, but not as strongly, particularly when you had ferritin, then that kind of trumped it, I think. I think that I think certainly you could collect data from the individuals to improve modeling either of the machine learning or the mechanistic model. But it seems like because the most important things are how long until you come back and the biomarkers, that you might be able to get, like the marginal benefits might be smaller because it seems like the biomarkers and time are the most important things.
Yeah. It's a bit of an aside, but I was just kind of shocked at the level of 5 was applicable and not that much. Like, can't give blood when you're that low, can you?
Yeah, the threshold used in South Africa right now for a ferritin deferral is pretty low. I think that they're hoping to raise it, but they're just worried about the blood supply. But now that they've introduced providing iron supplements to all of their repeat donors, like they're hoping to gradually increase it. And I think you have to remember that most blood collectors around the world are not measuring ferritin in any of their donors. So I think that when you consider it in that context, like at least it's a start, but I think they are hoping to do
better. They're doing the fingerprint.
Yeah, most blood collectors are only doing finger stick hemoglobin.
Yeah. Okay.
And plenty of people have regular normal hemoglobin with totally absent iron stores. Yeah, 5 is below the threshold for absent iron stores, so it does seem low. But I think they're just trying to gradually calibrate things without rocking the boat in terms of having sufficient supply.
Are there any other questions online or in the room? Then I will say thank you very much, Alton.
Thank you.